We are covering the part 5 of the cosmic worlds, which the title Brahma Jyoti. Many kinds of yogis doing spiritual endeavors besides karmis. We have many yogis doing spiritual endeavors. Karma yogis, Ashtanga yogis, who are actually also called Raja yogis or Kundalini yogis, and then Jnana yogis and Bhakti yogis. Actually, Bhakti yogis, we don't really call as Bhakti yogis. We call straight away a good name, devotees. Right? So if you see the karmis, they do good karma or bad karma. So depending on what they do, they will go to heaven, hell, whatever the so they are not really going to go beyond. Unless they really come to the karma yogi stage. So when they come to karma yogi stage, they do the duty and offer the results to the God, to Krishna in this case. So that is karma, that is actually karma yoga. So karma yoga is basically, in a nutshell, you are not doing those things for your sake. You are doing for the sake of Krishna. Okay? So again, there is also two kinds. One is sa karma yoga. That means you are actually doing the yoga, even though you are doing an offering to the God, to Krishna, you may be expecting something out of it. But sannyasa karma yoga means you are not really going to get anything out of it. Completely given to Krishna only. So now you also have Ashtanga yogis who are actually doing Kundalini yoga or called Raja yoga. So their interest is quite different. Unlike even karmis actually want to do all the things for the sake of themselves, so that they can enjoy in the heaven. But here, they want power. So they want power. This is where all the Babas and, you know, so many people are there. They actually have, so those who have acquired the power, then they declare that they are also God. This is where the problem comes. So, but again, Ashtanga yogis, what is the focus? They do Kundalini yoga and they want power. That's what the Ashtasiddhis. Right? You all know that. Then you have the Jnanis and Jnana Yogis. They are chanting through all the scriptures and then trying to understand about God, the worlds, and who we are, and especially the knowledge of Brahman and the Jivas and the relation between us. So this is their focus. Jnana means, you know, they are not really going to be learning how the Fourier transform works or, you know, how the differential equations work. That is not the, you know, that's not the jnana. That's not the spiritual jnana. So this is spiritual side, right? So it's really different. Then comes the last one, that is bhakti yogis. So they are actually called again devotees. They do quite differently. They develop loving sentiment towards God to serve Him for His, that means for the sake of the God. So they are not really doing all this seva and all the things for their sake here. They really want to keep Krishna happy. That is what is pure bhakti. Pure devotee will be always, he will never look at, you know, trying to really get something for him. Rather, he will try to see that whatever he does is actually satisfying Krishna or not. But now I have a question. Where do they all go when they leave the world? Do all go to the same place? What do you think? No. Karmis, as I said, they will go to heaven or hell, depending on what they do. Karma yogis, they will go to higher material worlds, and then eventually, after again, they are trying more and more and more, they will keep on going, and eventually they will go to Brahman. Ashtanga yogis, Siddha Loka. Very good. Who said that? Oh, yeah, okay. Exactly. So their resonance is Siddha Loka. That's it. They will go there and then eventually they will also go further, and then eventually they will again merge into the Brahman. Where do the Jnana Yogis go? Brahman straight away. You don't have, you know, go to go through any of the thing mostly. So depending on, again, you know, so if they are really perfect jnana yogis, they will go all the way to the Brahman and then boom. Where do the devotees go? Definitely not Brahman. Spiritual world, correct? The abode of their God. Whatever they are worshipping, they will actually go to them. So if they happen to worship the, you know, like the demigods, they will go to their own planets, right? Yanti Deva, Yanti, you know, we have a sloka, you know, that Krishna told about. But one who really worship Lord Krishna, they will go to his own abode. What is his, you know, what is his abode? Goloka Vrindavan. And then if you really worship in the Sriman Narayan, he's also for form of Krishna, then they will go to Vaikuntha. So the destination is already decided depending on how, you know, your taste. Now, we just see, while everybody else is really eventually going to Brahman, the devotees really take a quite a different path. Very different. This is quite amazing. Okay? Guru Devam Vandam Sharana Ravindam Pankaja Padam Adharavindam Adharavindam Chaitanya Devam Charana Ravindam Pankaja Padam Bhajana Ravindam Bhajana Ravindam. So after praying Gurudev, so we are now starting the program. The biggest joke in this world is that Bhagavan Krishna comes from Brahman. What is the joke? What is the joke? Yes. I also heard, even in some of the places where, you know, like our own native place, right? They are supposed to be, you know, Ayyavali and all those, there are so many, religions there. Even they say that Krishna is coming from Brahman. When Lord himself came down as Lord Chaitanya, he simply could not resist laughing at this. For so many so-called asuras, that means non-devotees, Brahman or Brahma Jyoti is the highest. And there is absolutely nothing beyond that. This Apasiddhanta is called Brahma Vivarta Vada, headed by Lord Shankaracharya. Shankaracharya. Sripad Shankaracharya. The truth is, actually the truth is in the Krishna Parinama Tattva, which we are not going to go in that detail, okay? It's really going to be, you know, swirling your head. I'm not going to go there. But idea is, this is the belief Lord Chaitanya did not support. Because he is Krishna himself coming down. And look at how they all completely mutilated this whole philosophy. That's what he is also telling in even Bhagavad Gita. Because what? You know, they actually get all the dharma, they all get really gone, destroyed. So he comes again, yuge, he comes down again and again to re-establish all those things. So Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came to re-establish that. So that happened 500 years ago, he really came here. So when people really say that Krishna is really coming from Brahman, it is equivalent to saying that sun comes from its sun rays. Right? The sun. Okay, so someone says that. Yeah, you know, do you know the sun actually comes from its own sunlight? What will you do? Don't you laugh? And you think that person had to be admitted to the mental hospital. Sastras say again and again that Brahman is just an effulgence of Bhagavan Sri Krishna. Krishna is like the sun. And his effulgence is Brahman. Anga Kanti. From his body, spiritual body, not like the body we are talking about. From his spiritual body, so you know, this radiation is really, really, or rather, effulgence. I don't want to say the word radiation because that's, this effulgence, very nice effulgence is really coming all over the place. And that is what is Brahman. But the ignorance won't understand this. This is the problem. And Krishna says, this kind of misunderstanding will be there. So he said, yeah, actually they are not to be blamed. They are going by their own brain. So Lord Krishna himself says this. Manushyanam sahasreshu kaschit yadati siddhaye yadatam api siddhanam kaschin maam veti tatvadaha. He says, out of many thousands among men, one may endeavor for perfection. And of those who have actually achieved that perfection, even among them, hardly anyone knows me in truth. So this is as good as saying what? No one can understand Krishna. Not even the Vedas. But even, not even Vishnu Purana. Vishnu Purana cannot even understand Krishna. Because why? He's talking about Vishnu. And Vishnu is from Krishna. How can they understand Krishna? Because Krishna is going through Vishnu, they say he is avatar. See, that is kind of the interpretation we have. So even Purana, Sastras cannot understand. Then how can the people understand? This is the situation. So in the last class, we covered the material worlds. We saw that Mahavishnu is breathing out unlimited Brahmandas, forming mind-boggling galaxies and clusters and superclusters. Then we went above the material worlds, then to Tadastha, where we saw Mahavishnu really breathing out the innumerable Brahmandas. Today we will see even above. It is called Brahma Jyoti or Brahman or Brahmam, the effulgence of Lord Krishna coming down from his spiritual abode. His spiritual abode is even beyond Vaikuntha. Only very few fortunate souls actually know this fact. That is Krishna. Jaya Radha Madhava, Jaya Kunja Vihari, Jaya Radha Madhava, Jaya Kunja Vihari, Jaya Gopi Jana Vallabha, Jaya Giri Varadhari, Jaya Giri Varadhari, Jaya Gopi Jana Vallabha, Jaya Giri Varadhari, Jaya Giri Varadhari, Yashoda Nandana Praja Jana Ranjana, Yashoda Nandana Praja Jana Ranjana, Yamuna Tira Banachari, Yamuna Tira Banachari, Hare Krishna Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna Hare Hare, Hare Rama Hare Rama, Rama Rama Hare Hare. So Brahma Jyoti, we will now delve into it, but again I can, there is no time to really go that much and then get lost inside. In fact, I don't want to get lost in Brahman. So you are going to really hear a lot today, but remember, keep all the things, you keep your mind focused, because on July 19th I think we are going to have a major Gokul Jeopardy. It's going to cover not only today's class, previous two class I think we didn't have Gokul Jeopardy. It's going to be a different kind of game altogether, very complex, okay, because you are supposed to be really watching all these videos as well, okay, so it's going to be really complex, okay. Mega Gokul Jeopardy, something like that. So in between the material and spiritual world lies the causal ocean. We saw that. It is, now I am going to say that it is also called Braja River. Why it is called a river? While it is an ocean, why should somebody call it a river? Because looking from inside the egg-shaped shell of our Brahmanda, when you look at, by concept and everything, it is really look appears as flowing. A river is flowing there in the sky. Okay, so Braja River is another name for the same Kashal Ocean. So who is there in the Kashal Ocean? Mahavishnu, correct, yeah, Mahavishnu is there. So when one crosses the Braja River, they will land in the really concentrated, the predominant stage of Brahma Jyoti. That is called Brahman. Brahman is actually everywhere. But we don't really feel that much compared to when you really go beyond that Braja River. But when you cross that river, you won't believe, there is no return almost. It's a one-way finish. That's it. You cannot go back. You know, remember when you really try to go, you know, return your car? Remember they used to have a tire punching thing. Remember? You go in, then you cannot get back. Finish, that's it, closed. Okay, so is it dangerous? Of course it is. It is one way it is dangerous, and the other way you are really getting rid of all these material sufferings forever. Done, no more birth, unless Krishna wants to give another chance to come back to him. He does, but very rarely, because once you really go to the Brahman, you are there forever almost. It is even way higher than going to Indra Loka. Indra Loka, you know, you'll be talking about, you know, like it has been written somewhere, around 400 million, you know, earth years at least you will be staying there. How many? For millions of years, according to our, you'll be there. But that is nothing, alpa. And now Brahma Jyoti is even way long, so you'll be living almost there forever. But will you be living there? We are going to see that. What you will be doing, we are going to see today. Jnanis and yogis love to hear the word Brahman. They meditate, they dance, and they sing about it. And always dream about the Brahma Jyoti. Because for them, this is their ultimate destination. For them, there is nothing beyond. Nothing. Other than them, there are also so-called Mayavadis. They are also attracted to this Brahma Jyoti. Impersonal doctrines, fascinated by Lord's formless feature. They say, oh, God has no form. Why not? Well, we can have a form. Why can't he have it? No, he cannot have it. No, that's restricted. So that is their claim. So they claim there is nothing beyond Brahman. Aham Brahmasmi, I am Brahman. Sarvam kalvidam Brahma. Only Brahman is everywhere. So this is their philosophy. But what is that Brahman? Brahman is the most misunderstood vastu. Vastu means substance in the world. Why? Because it has no qualities. It has no attributes. Cannot be perceived. Cannot be seen. Cannot be heard. Cannot be touched. Cannot be nothing. You can't do anything. No wonder why everyone almost is ignorant about Brahman. Because they cannot really do anything. They have no idea of knowing about it. So Krishna says, meditating on my Brahman effulgence is very, very difficult for you to come back to me. That is why he comes in the Vigraha form. What is Vigraha? What is Vigraha? Deities. So he comes to us in the form of deities. So we can install by invoking his names, and then we really worship through him. So it is, you know, that is actually, you know, it is equivalent, very much equivalent to worship him directly. So he is merciful to enough to really come down like this. But whereas these jnanis, take the case of a yogi, they want to go in a different way. They want to really meditate. They want to churn their brain, you know, left and right, churn. That's what they will be doing. And how do they progress? They meditate on the mantra Om. Because that is the Brahma, it's called Nada Brahmam. So this Om has a certain frequency. That is what the same frequency that our earth and all the material world, everything is really breathing with. That's the same. They really basically, you know, chant so that they really get, you know, so much vibrated. And when they really go higher, things will happen. But it may be taking, I'm talking about, you know, maybe 100 or thousands of lifetimes for them. You know, practicing like this and like this. They die again as it, because Krishna says, whatever they did, you know, they'll be continue from there again. And keep going and keep going. But when they come to a stage, they will hear something in their Pingala Nadi. Pingala Nadi means right side. Ida Nadi is, Ida means left side. There is a nadi, that means nervous system running down from the left side, and also one running on the right side. Why we say that, you know, don't use your left hand to really offer flowers to Krishna? Because it's all connected through the Ida Nadi. So Pingala Nadi means right side, which is really spiritual. So this is material and that is spiritual. In your body, these two will be always fighting. You know, this side will be telling, I want that ice cream. But the other side, you know what? That has egg in it. No, but I want that. So, see, this is the fighting going on. Ida Nadi and Pingala Nadi, both fighting. But right side is always spiritual. Depending on how good you are on that. That is why Gurudev gives a mantra on your right ear. Because it's a, you know, it is spiritual. Okay, now, when they practice, what happens is in their right ring, you know, light ear, they will see, hear a ringing. Chin, 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 chin. Chin chin. You know, it will be because if we talk to the doctor, they say, oh, I think you have some hearing problem. They will say, no, you have to get your hearing test to be done, whatever. But actually, it is spiritual. Okay, so you know that will start coming, and it will be kind of a, it won't be bothering, but you will really feel pleasure of actually hearing it. Then they after again, if you progress, you will hear ringing bell, dang 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 dang. Remember? Okay, ring the bell. And then you say, oh, I'm here, you ring the bell. And then your spouse will say, I think you are crazy. You are going crazy. You are, you know, doing this is something wrong in your head. Go and then do a checkup again. You are already talking about chini chini, and now you are talking about, you know, some ringing, somebody's coming. This is bad. But if you go beyond, then you will hear conch. Oh, you know the conch, you see? You'll be hearing throughout, and you know, it'll vibrate in such a way that your skull is going to explode or something. This is the time that yogi declares that he himself is God. That is it. Most of the time that is finished. But if they do not stop there, if they really keep going, because what happens when they really hear those, they actually get astasiddhis already. That is why. So when they feel that, you know, they take something and, you know, then they rub that and they say, look at here, this is jasmine. Oh yeah, that is jasmine. Okay, what scent do you really want? Okay, he rubs something, he says, oh, I want a lotus. There you go, boom. Okay, now you this. Oh, that is a lotus. Oh, you are God. Finished. So the people who really, you know, they get attracted by these cheap, you know, the tricks because of this siddhic power, that is what makes that yogi to declare that he is God. This is the problem. So the problem is, the people are the main problem there. They are the one who really run. Hey, you know, that Babaji has so much power. You know, I got this and this, everything. And then, you know, he can even say, all right, you want some gold? There you go. Okay, he gives the gold. But the problem is, he will tell you, you know, after, you know, few, you know, like 20 something, what, 48 minutes or something, that will go away. It's not going to stay. But for them, it's all, you know, big thing, you know. You know, because I heard, you know, people, some Babaji, they have really shown even moon on their this thing. Yeah, look at, but they can do only certain time. After that, they, you know, he can't do it. So anyway, so if they continue after the conch, they will hear Veena doing, you know, like that, right? So Veena. Even if you really go higher, they will hear Kartal. Yeah, whatever you played. Actually, they are trying to... We can play all these things. Look at here. Everything is there in the temple room. Why do you have to really go through all kinds of things there? Right? And then you are going to hear flute. Flute. Nice flute song. Very nice. Then Mridanga will come. After that, this guy will be declared as mad. Because he already heard the flute of Krishna. He already heard the Mridanga of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Okay, which is also flute, another form of flute only. So he'll be declared by the entire world as a mad. So he'll be chucked out of the home by the spouse. Then you'll be on the road shouting, oh Krishna, oh Krishna. But usually you don't really hear that kind of people. Because why? Because right when they really hear the ringing bell, they are already got the siddhik power, no? They'll be out, finished. Okay? So this is the situation. Note that all these things are what we do it on the puja only, puja room. Right? So as they advance higher and higher, as I said, so the these sounds are actually very, very blissful. That is the thing. So this really vibrates in such a way, it's actually the part of the Nada Brahman. Okay, that's the basic very sound of the Brahman. But then they get mukti, right? Eventually, suppose they really keep going higher and higher, they will be liberated. There are five kinds of liberations. Sayujya. Okay, read. Somebody want to read. Okay, Sayujya. What is written? Sayujya means what? What is that? Merging into Brahman. Today we are covering that. That's why I'm really bringing these ones now. Okay. What is the next one? Salokhya. That means living the abode of Lord. Vaikuntha, Kailash, wherever it is. Sarupya. Having same opulence as of the Lord. Vaikuntha, it is so special. You know, if you are really that kind of, devotee, you'll be given four hands and then, you'll be like Narayan. Yes, he will give that. It's so merciful. Okay. And then, what is the next one? Samipya. Serving the Lord very near to him. Very, very near to him. Again, this is now in Vaikuntha, Kailash, all those. Then, Sarshtri. You will become a personal associate of the Lord. With him, wherever he goes, you are also going along with him. See that? Isn't it nice? But now what about the devotee of Lord Krishna? I didn't say anything. Why? What do they want? Definitely, the devotees of Lord Krishna will never want the Sayujya. What is Sayujya? I am going to show you why. Okay? So they will never want. Others also, they don't want. They will never ask. What do they want? No. They reject all these things. But what do they want? Hey, you are giving liberation all the way higher. Even as an associate of the Lord. They say no. Because? Why? Bhukti mukti spriha yavat pisasi hridi vartate tavat bhakti sukasyatra katam apyudayo bhavet. How is it possible for the ocean of devotional happiness to appear in the heart? As long as the witches of desire for sense enjoyment and liberation. Liberation is also a sense, also it's something you are asking. You may say, oh Bhagavan, give me liberation. I want mukti. No, Krishna devotee will never ask. Never. Maybe a devotee of Vishnu, Narayana, they will ask. That is the purpose they are really running. When the, Vaikuntha, remember the special day, everybody runs through that because they want to go to Vaikuntha. Krishna devotee will never be interested. He will observe the Ekadasi for one purpose. Bhakti Devi, please give me some menial job, for me to do so that I can satisfy Krishna. I can make Krishna happy. Then how do they end up in Goloka Vrindavan? See, right? Everybody, whenever ask them, where do you want to go? What do you say? Goloka Vrindavan. So now, a real Krishna devotee, will he ask? No. But you all asked. This is the difference. What do they want? They want only one thing. Krishna Prema. It means Krishna, the devotion, because this is exactly the gopis wanted. They were not, asking for anything, any favor. Their entire life was only to satisfy him. There is nothing else beyond that. That is the highest sutta. That is the sutta bhakti. So asking for liberation is not at all pure bhakti. In fact, asking for anything is not bhakti. Bhakti is to give, not to take. You understand? So because they want to serve the Lord for the enjoyment of Krishna, not for their enjoyment. So where do you want to go now? Do you want to go to Goloka Vaikuntha? What should you say? Wherever I can serve Krishna to make him happy. Even if he wants me to be born as a worm, no problem. That is exactly Mugundamala. He is talking so nicely. Wonderful. It's amazing. Now, on the other hand, the Mayavadis want to merge in Brahman. Brahman, this is their intense desire. They take the Sayujya, liberation, merging into Brahman, Brahma Jyoti. And they consider that as the topmost. Actually, it is the most foolish thing to do. As you said, devotees will never want. Why you do not want to go to, you know, this Brahma Jyoti and then merge in that? Why? 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 Tell me why.
Because once somebody is stuck there, we'll never be able to attain Krishna.
Correct. It's finished. You are actually, what? You are actually killing. You are making a spiritual suicide. See the two doves there. It is like your soul, right? You are actually going there. And then that Brahma Jyoti, you are boom, going and then done. After that, you cannot really do anything there. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu seriously warned that if anyone is attracted to Mayavada philosophy of Sripad Sankaracharya and read Viveka Sudamani, one will be doomed. I think I have a copy of this Viveka Sudamani here in the library. And when I really heard that, I stopped even looking at Viveka Sudamani. Because Mayavada philosophy is going to destroy your bhakti. For your bhakti, even asking even for higher mukti is inferior. Then what to say about this merging in Brahman? Want to merge where the subject and object are one and the same? Then you got the Mayavadi's blues. This is your problem. When Krishna and Radharani, with all their sakas and gopis, they were all here. And when the pastime was really done, they were actually returning back. But Radharani called one Gopa. His name was Gopa Kumar. So he said, "Oh, Gopa Kumar, we are all going straight. But you, I want a favor from you. I am ordering you to take the path from Bhuloka and coming all the way up to Bhurloka, Bhurloka, Swarloka, what are the other ones? Maharloka, yes? Okay, so you really go all the way, every one of them, and go through the abode of Lord Brahma. That means you already have gone through Indraloka also. Swarloka, right? Swarkaloka. Then eventually, again, Brahma Loka. Then you come out of it. Exactly what we are, our classes are actually going through. So he came out of the Brahmanda, and he saw the Kaushal Ocean, and then he really again went further, and he really came to the, where? Brahma Jyoti. Okay, big books, if you see that. Okay, you have very big books written about this whole thing actually happened. So, he was just hitting there, and when he was in the Brahma Jyoti, that Brahma Jyoti, if you see that, actually you have to go over that, right? You have a river, and then you have the Jyoti, and you have to really go through. But when he was in the Braja River and entering into the Brahma Jyoti, he got stuck. He could not come out. That's what the hand you are seeing. He is sucked by the Brahma Jyoti, Brahman. He could not come out. He was about to give up and be one with the Brahman. That is the Sayujya. Basically, Sayujya, you know, liberation. He was about to. But then he somehow remembered because what happens is, when you get into the Brahman and then get the Sayujya, you lose your identity. Absolutely nothing. That means, you know, it is like you are taking a deep sleep. In the sleep, you don't really remember who you are. Sleep forever. That is what Brahman is. The Sayujya Mukti is nothing but that one only. But he remembered the Gopal Mantra that his Gurudev gave. Gopal Mantra. Because some of you have really got that. You are lucky enough. Because you will be able to use that, you know, depending on how you have to meditate on it. Yeah, then at the time, the time will come. Then you need that mantra. Because that mantra, unless it is really gone in your mind so firmly, you cannot really remember. And once you really lose it, and then Brahman takes you over, finished. You cannot do anything. This is very important stuff. Why Radharani was really telling Gopakumar to go through that is to tell everybody, saying that, remember, you have a lot of problems there. A pure devotee should not really go through this path. So he uttered the Gopal mantra just before he was about to lose his identity. It was then the Gopal mantra, when it worked like a rocket. It just like that, boom, lifted him out. So he came out of that. And he is now, when he really crossed that, when you come out of the Braja River, and then going through the Brahma Jyoti, you will see Kailash. Gopakumar landed in Kailash. We will be starting those things afterwards. Okay? Now I am going to give a little quickly so that we really cover the whole aspect of the Brahma Jyoti. Then he went to Vaikuntha. Unfortunately, he was not happy. He was crying and crying. Okay, that's a big story. Why he was crying? Nobody in Vaikuntha used to be unhappy. Because Vaikuntha means you are really, there is no anxiety. But he got the same anxiety to the extreme. Then he was crying and crying. And finally, Narada Muni came to his rescue. He helped to him. He told, you go to Saket, go. You don't belong here. Vaikuntha is not for you. Because we'll just go through the detail later. So he went to the Saket. Where is Saket? There you go. You did, the bhajan you did very good. Yeah, very good. So then he went to the Lord of, the abode of Lord Rama. So when he went to the Saket, after some time, again, he was not happy. He was very unhappy. So Narada Muni came again for his help. Gopakumar was then directed to go to Dwaraka. This is not this Dwaraka. I'm talking about the Dwaraka in the spiritual world. This is a replica of that. After some time, he was not happy there either. Even Dwaraka, he was not happy. Dwaraka Krishna was there. He was the king. King of the kings. So opulent. In fact, that was a problem. So he didn't like it. Narada Muni again came and helped him to go to Goloka. When he went to Goloka, he was entering the Goloka, saw Krishna playing with his Gopa friends little far away. While herding the Surabhi and Kamadenu cows, Krishna saw Gopakumar. And Gopakumar saw Krishna. You know what happened? Gopakumar even lost his consciousness, completely what he was dressed, wearing or something, everything. And Krishna dropped the flute, everything, and he started running. So, both were running. Gopakumar is running from here and Krishna is running from there. And coming and coming, coming and coming. They forgot everything. And then, what happened? They just tried to embrace, they hit each other and then fell down unconscious. And he was saying, oh Krishna, oh Krishna. Then he was saying, oh Gopakumar, Gopakumar, you have come, you have come. Both were crying in tears. They embraced and rolled down and fainted. This is the sweet abode of Krishna. You don't really say, then they were about to really go for cowherding and playing and these and everything. All those. You cannot get it in any of the other abodes. Definitely not in Vaikuntha. You cannot say, oh Narayana, okay, let us go for cowherding and then we'll play on the flute. That's what he was asking. Then he was actually about to be punished. And the same thing again he tried to do in the Saket. No. That was what he was going higher and higher and higher and higher. That is the Eka Bhakti. You have to have Bhakti only in one Ishtadeva, Krishna. In fact, last week it was a little different, but that is not our this thing, because our Gurudev, even though he started as a Rama Bhakta, he got the vision of Ram. He said, Rama is a, Lord Ram is a Maryada Purusha. He even, just for the sake of following rules and regulation, he sent his own wife to really, you know, out of the home. And he even, because you know Hanuman did something funny, and because it was, you know, against Dharma, Ram was about to shoot arrow to really kill this thing, because of the, he's a Maryada Purusha. Our Gurudev said, I don't want Rama. Because if you make a small mistake, how much time he will take you to really finish you? Remember, Rasitanda is different. Even though we have Ram bhajans, we have a lot of things. Even Vanachari gopis, what kind of level they had. That Vanacharis gopis were so distant, they could not actually mingle with like other gopis. Vedas, Upanishad, they also came as gopis. Even Lord Shiva also tried to come in. They had a lot of problems. The Vanachari gopis were not really having complete, you know, they really wanted to enjoy the beauty of Ram. So now they are enjoying the beauty of Krishna. But they are not the way the gopis really want to give everything to Krishna. So our Siddhanta is quite different. And only our Guru and the Diksha Mantras, they can really save you. Because I don't know whether how many of you will be able to really traverse all the way to the Brahma, you know, Brahma Jyoti all the way by yourself. That itself is a question. Most of the Jivatma, they will be roaming around doing karma back and forth. And back into being born and dead and born and dead. But even if you go to that Brahman, there is a big danger of getting stuck there. And you need the mantras. And that only Guru can give. That is the Diksha Mantra. That can save you from singing in that dangerous Brahman, the eternal death for you. Only by going beyond the Brahman, the Brahma Jyoti, you can see the Lord. But you have absolutely no strength to go beyond. Why? Because you want that rocket. That rocket I really showed you. Can you build and then, you know, take it with you? That rocket is that Brahmastra, that the Gopal Mantra that the Guru is actually giving to you. That is the Brahmastra. Very powerful. You cannot build that. No way. This you will get only from a powerful Guru. Only they can give bhakti and you can find Krishna. You will get that kind of devotion.
Where can you hide from me? Where can you run from me? Krishna, where can you hide from me? Where can you run from me? I will catch you, I will. Where can you hide from me? I will find you, I will catch you, I will. Where can you hide from me? Krishna, where can you hide from me? Where can you run from me? Krishna, where can you hide from me? Where can you run from me? You come from Goloka, Vehai from Vaikuntha. Krishna, you come from Goloka, Vehai from Vaikuntha. The Vishnus come from you, you are not avatar. Where can you hide from me? All the Vishnus come from you, you are not avatar. Where can you hide from me? Krishna, where can you hide from me? Where can you run from me? Krishna, where can you hide from me? Where can you run from me? Krishna, you hide us, Paramatma, in the heart of Jeevatma. Even great rishis, yogis can't find you, oh Krishna, where can you hide from me? Even great rishis, yogis can't find you, oh Krishna, where can you hide from me? Krishna, where can you hide from me? Where can you run from me? Krishna, where can you hide from me? Where can you run from me? You shine as bright Brahma. Shine as bright Brahman, that comes from you, Bhagavan. Blinded like a fly through fire, jnanis run and die there, Krishna, where can you hide from me? Blinded like a fly through fire, jnanis run and die there, Krishna, where can you hide from me? Krishna, where can you hide from me? Where can you run from me? Krishna, where can you hide from me? Where can you run from me?
If you really have strong guru who is really so powerful, you don't have to worry about it. You automatically will get connected to Krishna. This is the secret. Once you are connected, you don't have to singing in the Brahma Jyotis and, you know, losing your identity. Never. It will go straight there. So you have to stay away from the Mayavadis, which are called Advaitas. They will say there is no God, or God has no form. I am God. You, yourself, you are also God. Aham Brahmasmi, I am Brahman. Sarvam Kalvidam Brahma. So Lord Chaitanya gave a very big warning actually. So as I told you, this philosophy, he actually destroys the bhakti and will be swallowed by Brahman. You will be finished. This is the problem. But how can you recognize a Mayavadi? Of course, as I mentioned, he will say like this. The Mayavadi will tell you, there is no God, or God has no shape. I am God and you yourself are God. Aham Brahmasmi Sarvam Kalvidam Brahma. Such a person will not chant. Very easy to find out actually. Okay, how to recognize? Very easy to. They will never chant. They don't have any interest in chanting. They don't have any faith in chanting. They don't want to remember Lord. Because you are God, no? Why should you really want to really remember? Nothing. And he is not coming to associate with high class devotees. See, like you all here, hearing something, you know, the Pramur Shastra, they won't come. You will be recognizing very easily. This is what our Gurudev mentioned. So we'll be finishing it soon, almost. So now, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came to condemn Mayavadism. Nirvishesha Sunyavadi Paschatyave Desha Tarine. So he really purposely came down to really clear this so that he can actually bring the, you know, make devotees, right? So now what happened to us? Once what happened to us, some of the Mayavadis that time, they really wanted to give some trouble. They cooked some, you know, the meat, okay? You know, because he thought, oh, he's a sattvic sannyasi and everything, and, you know, we should be okay. We should be testing. So they brought a big plate of this cooked meat. And They really, you know, God and them, oh, this is for you as an offering, it actually comes there. But before they entered in the arena, one Garuda straight away came from, nobody knew where it came from. It came and then hit the plate in such a way that it was by the force, they themselves were, what, you know, injured. They all fell down, injured. So the thing is, they will give problem. They will come in and challenge you. But unless you really have a strong guru, you have no way of escaping from them. But then, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu gives a real meaning of all this. You know, what is the Brahma Jyoti? Hiranmayena patrena satyasya pihitam mukam tatvam pushan apavrunu satya dharmaya drishtaye. Isha Upanishad is actually also telling, oh Lord, sustainer of all that lives, your real face is covered by your dazzling effulgence. That is called Brahma Jyoti. Kindly please remove that covering and show yourself to your pure devotee. That is exactly that I am talking about. They will, you have to, what? Get away from the Brahman and then go, pierce through that and then get out. That is what you should really do. This is so Upanishad nice, telling nicely. Now, this is another thing. This is again from the Chaitanya Charitamrita. It says, Brahma Anga Kandi Tandra Nirvisesa Prakashe Surya Yena Charma Chakshe Jyotirmaya Bhashe. The manifestation of impersonal Brahman is simply the rays of Krishna's spiritual bodily effulgence. It is like the sun. When the sun is seen by ordinary eyes, it appears to only consist of effulgence. Similarly, when we try to see Bhagavan, we are unable to penetrate his effulgence to see the beautiful form of Krishna within. Rather, we are blinded by the powerful rays of the impersonal Brahman. So this is the fact. Now, though the real meaning of Aham Brahmasmi means I am spiritual and eternal. So, you know, like for some reason, Shankaracharya was really forced to really do it in a different way. I will actually show to you. And then, also the Mayavadis who actually claim they are the God, they have taken some verses and then they confused it. Okay, they tweaked it. Tattvam asi. Tattvam means, the literal meaning is, you are that. But you are what? You can interpret in any way you want. Lord Shankaracharya, he interpreted that you are that Brahman. Because, why? For them, Brahman is the highest. And then Ramanujacharya, who really came and defeated the Mayavadism, he said, Satat Tattvamasi. Satat Tattvamasi. That is the actual sloka he said. That means you belong to God. Then Matvacharya even went through that. Even because in the Sanskrit grammar, you can make some small changes to really, to really convey the meaning the way you want. That's the problem with the Sanskrit. You can, actually you take any script, any script from Sanskrit, and you can actually explain it in your own way. Because every word has probably about, more than 100 meanings. So which meaning you will take is up to you. And then you can actually twist that. Exactly, Shankaracharya did that actually. So here it means is, you are that. But you are what? So you can assume anything. Ramanujacharya said, you belong to God. He said, Satatvamasi. Matvacharya said, Atatvamasi. You are not that God. He put a A in the beginning. Atat Satva, Atatvamasi. But then, Lord Chaitanya came to reveal the right meaning. Now, before that, I need to take a minute to explain why Shankaracharya taught Mayavada. It is very simple. To turn away the non-devotees of Krishna. If you see that, Mayavadis have an affectionate with who? Lord Shiva. Usually that's what they do. Because they are not the devotees of Krishna. They want to go ulta. Remember, even when Lord Krishna comes down, Lord Shiva will be really favoring to some asuras and they'll be fighting with each other. This is usually, always happen. If you read the Shiva Tattva, you will see that all the time there. So this Shankaracharya, why did he do that? Lord Krishna requested Lord Shiva Sadashiva to do, because Lord Sadashiva is a first Vaishnava. He is a Vaishnava. But he has taken the tamasic role to really bring up all the asuras to the next level. That is, it's a big job. It's very, very merciful. So now Chaitanya Mahaprabhu told that, yes, this was the thing that, you know, because I really instructed him to do this. Why? Because by coming to the worship of Krishna, these asuric people, just for the sake of their own material, you know, desire, they are actually, you know, they are actually worshipping me. They are trying to worship me for what? Not for bhakti, for their own favor. You have to keep them away. But how can I do that? You do one thing. You tell them that they are the God. They don't have to worship me. They are the God. And direct them away. And whoever has that mentality of not desiring for bhakti, Krishna bhakti, right? But instead they are really trying to get some favor from the God. You reflect them out, completely throw them out. Those are asuras. You have to do this. But he did not. He was crying. Who told all this? Chaitanya Mahaprabhu told. So in fact, when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu went to South India tour, Lord Shiva, Sadashiva and Durga Devi, they actually came as a Brahmin family. And they were actually living in a hut in South India. I think it is somewhere in the Andhra Pradesh side. And Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was really coming through. And he stayed 7 days with them. And they were discussing all kinds of, you know, like confidential things there. And this is there written in Chaitanya Charitamrita. If you read that, 9167 to 176. It is there, clearly mentioned there exactly about this one. So the real meaning, is such a real purpose of why the Mayavadism came was to divert these non-devotees out of Krishna so that they get lost. That's what Lord Krishna also saying in Bhagavad Gita. You can worship any God you want. I will support you even. Why should he support? Because you already have the mentality to go there like that. You know, Ganesh or whatever it is. You really go or Murga, whatever. Those demigod worship, the worship is going to be already, you know, it is in your mind because you are what? Tricked by your own desires. Because if you don't have desire, if you really want Krishna Bhakti, you are not going to go there. It automatically comes to Krishna. And Krishna is not going to give all kind of things. No. He will honor only Bhakti. Do you understand that? There is a lot of things involved. That is why if we see all the religions in this world, there is a purpose. They are really trying to bring in, you know, they are trying to do some particular objective. That's what actually happened. So you have to understand that. But however, Sripad Shankaracharya, even though he taught, he took so many Mahavakyas, you know, like there are four Mahavakyas, like Aham Brahmasmi, and again, Tattvamasi, all those things are all, you know there are two more. There are Mahavakyas. He took it, and because of the Sanskrit grammatical power, he twisted. In fact, for the Brahma Sutra, he wrote the description several times. It took years and years. Because he wrote once complete in a description, he was not satisfied. He threw that up. Again, he really started from again. Again threw up. So many iterations that he had to go through to correctly twist as Lord Krishna wanted. But at the end, he had to tell the truth. No. Whatever I did is wrong. Like Vedavyasa. Vedavyasa wrote that, you know, 18 Puranas and 18, you know, like Upapuranas, and finally he was about to kill himself. Then Narada Muni, his Gurudev Narada Muni came. What did he do? This is nonsense. And you wrote Devi Purana, you said Devi is the highest deity. And then he really wrote another Purana, you said that's the highest. You cheated the people. That's why, you know, he was instructing. That is why you are, you know, about to kill yourself. Because you did very bad. So now to rectify all those things, you have to write one Purana. Right now, sitting down now. And that should be about Lord Krishna. You wrote so many things, all the karma kandas, Mahabharata, these and everything. What is the use? They're all karmic pranas. And they're all actually dying, you know, like these are all, you know, they're all actually trying to follow and then they are getting lost. You have to write a Purana, which is, that's what Srimad Bhagavatam. And first thing it starts like that. This Purana nullifies every other Purana that I have done. This is like a prayachitta. I am really doing it. I am rewriting. I am actually developing something. That is why Chaitanya Mahaprabhu also has said, throw out all the Purana, including Vishnu Purana. Throw all the Puranas. Only one Purana you need is Srimad Bhagavatam. It's Amala Purana. Okay, we'll actually cover that data. Amala Purana. It doesn't have it. So even any other Purana says something else, you follow what is there in the Srimad Bhagavatam. Because what? Lord Krishna gave direct darshan, and he was the one who was actually, you know, giving everything, supplying all the things that were there for him to write. So here, Sripad Shankaracharya, at the end he realized, he cried. So because he did the Asat Siddhanta or Apa Siddhanta, he had to reveal the truth at the end before he leave. When Acharyas and Gurus leave, they will reveal at the end one thing they will never reveal before. What is that? Anyone? Their identity. That is the last thing they do. Until then, they will not disclose that. The same way, Lord Shankaracharya wrote this at the very end. And when he said, Bhajagovindam, 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 all the disciples thought, oh, he is now mad. He was teaching that we ourselves God. Now he is saying, Bhajagovindam, Bhajagovindam, and Muda. He is calling us Mutta, you know, fools. Muda Madhe. Are, throw the grammars out. In fact, he wrote for himself. I misinterpreted the, you know, the Sanskrit using this grammatic, you know, whatever I could do, because Lord Krishna wanted me to do. Now, to cancel that everything, like Vedavyasa wrote the Srimad Bhagavatam, he wrote the Bhajagovindam, and the Bhajagovindam is, he did it in his deathbed. So the purpose of this, you know, our life is what? To really do bhajan for Lord Krishna. Govinda. So his disciples actually thought they are completely gone mad. So he is saying, Hari bhajan. Do Hari bhajan. Throw everything out. See, he is saying, you know, you are fools. You are actually misinterpreting all the sastras in the way you want, and then trying to really, you know, chant your brain here and there and then get lost. No. Bhaja Govindam. That is the only thing that you have to do. So now, this is exactly what all the Hari bhajans, our Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and all the six Goswamis, that's what they really want us to do. Now Lord Chaitanya came here because so many Advaita Vada, you know, Dvaita Vada, so many Vadas are there. There are Vadas. Vada means, you know, Vada means there is another name is, you know, yeah, arthritis. Okay. So those are all actually arthritis only. But Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came to reveal the Tattva. So everything else is called what? You know, Advaita Vada, Dvaita Vada, then what is Vishishtadva Vada, all the things are Vadas only. But he said, I am giving the Tattva now. Achindya Beda Abeda Tattva. He gave the truth. All others gave only Vada, only hypothesis. Vada means hypothesis. Jivas and Bhagavan are simultaneously one in many ways, like quality, etc. But different in other ways. And it is very difficult to conceive because we are materially contaminated. So Vedas actually support only Achintya Veda Abheda Tattva by Lord Chaitanya. You are ready? So we are indebted to Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu in so many ways. Because he was the one who really gave, you know, remember all the right scriptures and right thing to do and six Goswamis. Because remember, you know, we are actually talking about, we had, you know, in actually Bharat, our country, they had so many wonderful universities. Actually, you know, Dr. Pritima, you know, we are talking about wonderful university. So many things, all the Muslim invaders really, they totally, you know, demolished. They are gone. And many, many scriptures were really taken to Tibet and they are still there. But so many are gone. But when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came, The first thing he did was he engaged all the six Goswamis to reveal those, some of them, they are Bhakti Sastras, which we missed it, which got destroyed. So that these six Goswamis, they have written so many details. That's what we are actually reading. So we are so fortunate to really come under Gurudev, who is actually in the line of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And we have to sing the glory, because Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is the amazing avatar who descended, is the most merciful. You even take Krishna himself, or Lord Narayana, Lord Vishnu, or whoever you want, no one will be this merciful. He gave the holy names free, absolutely free. That is the glory of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And we have a bhajan. Yes, why don't you lead?
Chaitanya Deva Namo Namo Sarvarakshaka Namo Namo Oh,
Krishna, Krishna,